At the Port of Albany, the Hudson becomes a channel for ocean-going vessels from around the world. From this point on to New York City, the river is practically at sea level, making it an estuary or arm of the ocean, feeling the force of the ocean's tides. The tidal action can be easily observed where a small tributary meets the river. At low tide, the stream is clearly visible. 6 hours later, it disappears under 4.5 feet of the flood tide. The Algonquian Indians, after observing this, called the river Mahikonituk, the great river that flows both ways. After 1609, when Henry Hudson explored the river for the Dutch, it was called the North River, or the River of Prince Mauritius. The Dutch had a strong influence on the Hudson Valley and the Indian tribes who lived there. It's been estimated that over two-thirds of the river Indians died from diseases which the early settlers brought with them from Europe. What the Europeans took over was a river valley rich with game, fish, and fertile land. A place which was described by some as a type of paradise. This paradise was later idealized in the paintings of the Hudson River School, the first major movement in American art. During the 19th century, there were many artists who contributed to this movement in landscape painting. They traveled the world over, but they chose to build their homes in the Hudson Valley, a region they preferred over the most exotic locations. Their homes ranged from rustic cottages to grand estates, such as Olana, which was built by Frederick Church, one of the most successful of the Hudson River School painters. Church took an active part in the design of his home and considered it to be one of his major works of art. It has a strong Persian influence and overlooks a commanding view of the Hudson. Like his colleagues, Church was a world traveler. He studied the atmospheric sunsets in Jamaica and became famous for his depiction of the Andes, but he kept returning to Olana, which was a constant source of inspiration. Church once wrote to a friend, "About an hour this side of Albany is the center of the world."
When I started this painting, it was nice and clear. Now, as you can see, you can hardly see the mountains, but I've got them in. I have the option, though. I can take them out, or I can quiet them down. I'm going to keep them in, though.
George Wilcox, like the artists of the Hudson River School, would argue that the Hudson is one of the most beautiful rivers in the world.
I was raised in New York City, and the Hudson River, to me, was just a river. It was just always there. I'd never thought about it one way or the other. And even when I moved upstate, it was a river. It wasn't until I traveled and saw all the famous rivers in Europe that I realized how marvelous this is. I mean, the Arno, the Seine, the Thames, they're mudflats. This is a gorgeous thing, and it's still wild. The Rhine is beautiful, but the Rhine is cultivated. Every inch is mowed. But the Hudson is wild, and it's just, there's nothing like it that I've ever seen, because I haven't seen everything. I haven't been down the Amazon. But it is an absolutely special river. It is gorgeous.
George Wilcox paints in the open air, unlike the artists of the Hudson River School, who executed their final works in a studio. In spite of the differences, Wilcox still feels a connection to their work.
I've been called a neo-Hudson River School painter, yes, yes. And of course, I love their work, there's no question about that. But you know, when I was a kid, you didn't hear much about them, and you couldn't even see them at the Metropolitan. They were kept down in the basement. They were not considered terribly important. And it took me a long time to discover them and to realize how marvelous they really were.
The Hudson River School painted during a period of rapid growth and technological development, marked by the opening of the Erie Canal and the invention of the steamboat. Although artists may have shown a steamer coexisting next to a Hudson River sloop, the growth of technology signaled an end to the pastoral way of life. The age of the sloop, which was the main method of transporting cargo since the times of the Dutch, was giving way to the age of steam, an era that would last on the river for over a century.